In the darkness of outer space, a behemoth of intelligent hands inches toward a planet called Earth, in the middle of a solar system that calls a spiral arm of the Milky Way galaxy its home. The person speaking to you was born on that planet, and so were all of you. Earth, in all its blue purity, is ours. All of her affairs belong only to us, but typically most humans don't care. It's all we know. How could we? But what would make you care? What would make us care?
This is the century. This is the century. This is the century to your immortality. How many strong are we? Bring down the enemy. This is the calling. We're not fooling. We can set you free. This is the sun. This is the sun. Your turn to shine. We will make history. We will make history. We will make history.
Independence Day, directed by Roland Emmerich and written by Dean Devlin and Roland himself. This film concerns our planet being unequivocally pillaged and conquered by a race much similar to our own. All of Earth's cities are victim to the complete annihilation of culture, safety, and the very lives of the people walking their streets. Yeah, but come on, let's be real here. Independence Day is a blockbuster popcorn movie meant to be watched and enjoyed under the guise of entertainment. This was said by the creators themselves, and they're pretty vocal about it, let's be real here. They've always been. So what exactly am I here to talk about? ...1990s America, the heyday of its culture and power. Everything seems fine. Days go by as normal, but a shadow casts itself upon everything that stood for that very success. The ships. Oh, the ships. At first, these are the only and main visuals we see of this alien species. These 15-mile saucers netting its aura hundreds of feet above the World Trade Center, the Empire State Building, the White House, and many other significant structures representing our empire over this planet. However, the film chooses to share the ship's focus with the reactions of the characters below. The president and his secretary, David Goldblum, Malcolm Mann and his colleagues, Hiller and his family. Although the film takes a fairly long time going through all these characters' introductions, it all serves the atmosphere of discovery, and the terror that that discovery entails. Clearly taking inspiration from Steven Spielberg, Roland Emmerich chooses to show people's reactions to the alien ships before revealing what they're seeing, lingering on shots of onlookers, news reports, shaky camera footage of what's happening above, and sequences of hysteric scrambling to find out just what it is that the world is dealing with. I, for one, think the dialogue here is very enticing. Not only is it well acted, but what they're discussing sounds like a legitimate back and forth between real people trying to navigate and debate an unprecedented situation.
This thing may just pass us by.
What if it doesn't pass us by? Let's retarget some ICBMs to blow it out of the sky.
And risk turning one dangerous falling object into many.
We don't yet know enough about what we're dealing with to make any kind of intelligent judgments.
Luckily, the press is making up their own story at this point.
General, contact NORAD. You tell them we've upgraded to DEFCON 3.
It's not what the president
said.
We're
2 days away from the 4th of July. We have over 50% of the armed forces out on weekend leave, not to mention the commanders and troops that are in town for the 4th of July parade.
The ships are not as hidden as the dinosaurs are in Jurassic Park in its first 20 minutes, per se. But the effect is still intense. It's strangely realistic, especially for what the filmmakers have very vocally projected as the point of their own film. Every one of these characters, well, most of them, serves the greater aura of impending disaster. The tension builds and builds. It doesn't stop, and the release of this tension is satisfying. It delivers. These invaders quarter themselves at our doorstep and choose destinations that not only have economic and judicial power, but have symbolic substance to our culture. Who we are, the systematic and intentional rape of humanity's identity, the feeling of waking up one day and realizing you and everyone else around you are now victims in a powerless situation you didn't even think was possible, only for that situation to slowly, arduously, painfully spiral into more confusion, bellowing fear, and the realization that we never stood a chance from the start. The rest of the film, although something I unironically love watching, has a hard time matching up to the excellence of the first act. But despite that, it still accomplishes the overwhelming feeling of being powerless. The first air battle is very well shot. Fighter jets piercing the dulled red colored sky, almost like they're flying into hell, like they're walking to their deaths, which most of them are. I love the apocalyptic nature of the concept, and the aftermath of what the aliens have done to Earth. They eradicated it in less than an hour. The overwhelming finality to the manner in which the aliens conquer our planet is just so frightening to me. Conceptually, the scale is just massive. It inspires me. It really does. The effects hold up well. The score is fantastic, as it's done by David Arnold. But I do feel that, although there is much I still legitimately love about this movie, a lot of its, quite frankly, genius ideas are kind of bogged down by the second act's slow nature, and a lot of unnecessary characters that don't really add much to the overall story. For instance, this pilot over here and his family should have just been cut out entirely and had its story arcs reinterpreted through the other more interesting characters. We already have a pilot in Will Smith, and he's way more interesting. But instead of putting time into a smaller but more distinct group of characters, Roland and Dean pretty much stretch themselves thin with a lot of pretty aimless plot lines. Point is, there's too many fucking characters, and I would have liked more time with the ones that are actually important, like David Goldblum, Malcolm Man, Willow, and Lone Star. That's good enough for me, but I don't really mind the eye candy too much. The cheese is oh so delicious, but sometimes it gets a little bit too cheesy. Problem Roland loves not fixing in his movies is the archetypes he writes into them. We got the nerd who cares for the environment, the military dude, the scientist, general. I'm not saying these specific characters are bad, but I notice it feels like these archetypes, borderlining on parody sometimes, are just in Emmerich's movies because he's kind of just being lazy. It's like he feels like he has to put those in out of some misguided stipulation that it won't be complete without them. But he doesn't try hard enough to make these archetypes stand out most of the time, so usually the nerd is just the nerd. Like, look at this. What? Yes, I think most people know that Independence Day is a very flawed film, but a lot of people really seem to not give this film any holdbacks. You either like it, or you think it's the epitome of Hollywood stupidity. I, however, am not that nihilistic. This film has its place in popcorn cinema, but that notion I feel really has taken away from the legitimate artistic integrity of the content of the film. The hellish nature of the visuals, and the overall tone, while much more optimistic than, let's say, Steven Spielberg's War of the Worlds, is very much rooted in withdrawal, retreating, taking refuge, and hiding from a threat none of these characters have a hope in hell trying to confront. Like I've said in my other videos, I love things that frighten me, concepts that disturb me on a deeper, primal level. And this shit does frighten me. This story is very unsettling. It's probably because I've always found stories where the human race is either hunted or now the minority on Earth to always really bother me. It genuinely makes me uncomfortable. And this stuff is an Independence Day, 100%. Just look at these aliens. The creature design is from Patrick Tatopoulos. He's one of my favorite creature designers. Hell, I actually think he is my favorite. He redesigned Godzilla, he did concept art for the Mario movie, he did work for Stargate. His designs are organic and gothic at the same time. All of his designs have a very scrawny and mechanical aura attached to them, and none are so potent as the Independence Day aliens. Their bodies long, slim, slimy, and segmented like insects, but with a humanoid build and a giant cranium, very much resembling, to me at least, seashells, hard and sturdy, but still biological, still organic. And that's very fitting, seeing as these are actually biomechanical suits for the actual aliens, which are a strangely original update to the gray aliens' look in pop culture. The blue undertones to the aliens' culture itself is so beautiful to look at. Even their skin looks like a blue, translucent, pulpy insect body. It really is stunning. I could look at these designs for hours. But let's not forget that these aliens are not animals. They are malicious, intelligent beings who actively want us exterminated. And with that context, and well, quite frankly, just the designs themselves, an aura of fear is what permeates through Independence Day's identity in its visuals. They look like an other. They are designed to look like the enemy.
I did two concepts for the alien. I did one that was this tall alien fantasy, let's say. Not the way people picture an alien to look like, a real alien.
So what we did, you know, we kind of created first like an image of the alien, which you think it's not like what you think they look like, to later then discover, you know, in a surprise, that they exactly look like we think they should look like.
Those aliens live on a planet where other creatures live around. They take those big, dumb aliens, but very powerful, they treat them have their face split open and just fit in there and travel space this way. So they actually become strong creatures, physically strong. They're actually very clever beings, but they need to be physically strong to travel space.
Malicious race of beings, hell-bent on the destruction of Earth. This also carries over to the designs of the ships themselves. Giant city-like ships that you can argue have their own gravitational pull. This haunting imagery goes down as one of my favorite concepts in film, or just fiction. Science fiction specifically, I suppose. Unimaginably large ships, ones that rival the planets they land on, like the Death Egg, or the Exilian Mothership. It's all so scary, so overpowering.
The more massive the element looks like, and actually working for those designs, I started to really realize that actually the simple shape makes the thing look much more massive. And that's at that point a direction where I told that thing, thinking, okay, simple, elegant, and massive.
Given that, I think the aura that surrounds this movie is genuinely so interesting. The movie can be pretty innocent and lighthearted sometimes, which is okay. I actually think it's pretty endearing when it is, although this lightheartedness does take away from the drama of the film. There's a good amount of it, but there's a lot of instances where the Hollywood blockbuster-isms get in the way of otherwise normal human reactions. Take this scene where Hiller and his friend are about to fight the alien ship.
Scared, man?
Nope.
You? Nope. Hold me.
Hey, pay attention.
This is directly after an atom bomb level event destroyed the city Hiller's wife was in. He shows concern about it, yes, but only after he's done goofing off with his friend. These are good characters. I like them. I do. There's actually some pretty interesting and well-performed dialogue in scenes like this where David is having a little chat with his wife.
To the end of the world.
Well, he didn't come to this decision lightly. He didn't have any other choice.
Yeah. Well, he's still believing him.
Well, he's a good man.
Well, he better be. You left me for him. Or, you know, for your career.
See, now, it wasn't just my career. It was the biggest opportunity of my life.
And, I wasn't, ambitious?
David, you could have done anything that you wanted. Research, development.
Oh, just... honey, I was happy where I was.
Haven't you ever wanted to be part of something special?
Was part of something special.
It's a well-done scene. I just wish it was in more of the film. I think the project would have benefited if the story focused more on these three families, personally dealing with the alien invasion while confronting their mishandlings of their own lives. This is a vague theme about unity, coming together as a race to defeat a greater threat, but it focuses on so much other shit that it really isn't potent until this pretty chilling and bombastic speech from the president. It's dramatic and gung-ho, which I love, but I can tell this was something the filmmakers probably wanted to be more of a main theme. It's just not as focused as it could be. The movie is American-centric, which is fine, but seeing its desire to be a very global story, it leaves you wanting to see more countries and groups of people taking on the alien threat as well. However, there were several novels written after the film's release that apparently go far deeper into the lore than the movie does, which is pretty fucking exciting, to be honest. As you can see, I really do believe in Independence Day's concepts, so you can imagine how psyched I would be to get a look into the deeper story that is sewn into the fabric of this movie's plot. According to what I've read, there's this one named War in the Desert, where the aliens attack Jerusalem, and the prequel to the horribly generic but still interesting sequel, Independence Day Resurgence, called Crucible, that dives into a city destroyer that landed in the Congo. According to the bio, there are pockets of aliens still left after the defeat. I hope there's some ground trip alien action like there is in the sequel. That'd be sick. I really want to get to these pretty soon. Independence Day's strengths are in its central characters, their well-written dialogue between each other, and the overarching feeling of fear through these larger-than-life events. A much better film lays within its groundwork. The movie itself has a lot of problems, and laziness is definitely woven into its writing. They don't go full ham on all the concepts, but very evidently, it doesn't really bother me as much as you'd think. What is here is still a good movie, flaws and all. What lays in this film is imagery and ideas I will never forget. Ideas that still bring awe to me, even 10 years after I first watched it on a random 4th of July in the mid-2010s. Happy Independence Day.
is going to be the White House, and we're building that at 12 scale, which is over 14 feet wide, and we're going to blow it up.